but you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. You gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down, hey. I know it's hard, no, it's hard to remember sometimes, but you gotta keep your head up, oh, and you can let your head down.
Hi, Mrs. Joseph. Thank you so much for popping on per usual. It's just me here tonight. I actually am hosting solo tonight because we had some scheduling conflicts. So many of our regular panelists will not be here tonight to talk about our topics. So I'll just be hanging here, letting any attendees chit chat with me if they want to, say hello. And tonight's topic is about social emotional learning. So feel free to stick around. If not, I'm just going to be hanging here, waiting for more attendees to pop in. Hi, Tracy. Thank you so much for popping on. Tonight, I am hosting solo. Our topic is about SEL, and if you have any advice for a first-time teacher, I am here and I'm definitely all ears. But unfortunately, we had some scheduling conflicts, so other panelists will not be here tonight. It will just be me. So feel free to add some in the chat. Join us next week. And if you do have some information to share, I'd be happy to move you over as a panelist to have a conversation. So definitely just let me know, or we'll be happy to have you next week as well. You can definitely come over to panelists if you have some information to share. I can do that now. And hello, Lori. Welcome to Mentor Roundtable. As I was just telling Tracy and Mrs. Joseph here, is that unfortunately due to scheduling conflicts, it's just me here tonight. So we can definitely have a conversation about SEL and, okay, promote to panelist. So Tracy, I just pulled you over for whenever you're ready, and we're just gonna have a conversation. Feel free to put stuff in the chat if you have anything to comment about SEL, or I'd be happy to move you over if you wanna send in a chat, Lori. And if not, we'll be here next week at 8:30 as well. Hi, Tracy.
Hey, I didn't realize everything was muted.
That's okay. Yeah. I know, Zoom is tough. How are you?
I'm well. Thank you. This is a topic that's really near and dear to my heart. So I wanted to make sure, I kept watching my clock to make sure I didn't get distracted and, you know, start doing something else. So
yeah, that would be great. I'm sure we'll talk about it next week too, once we have all of the regular mentors back. But I am a first year teacher. I'm teaching in Massachusetts right now. I just went to all remote. I'm a third grade teacher. And so I am definitely all ears for any tips and tricks that you may have. Where are you teaching?
I'm in Mansfield, which is, you know, in Texas, and I teach cool. kindergarten, but I've taught third grade actually, and been a reading specialist, an instructional coach. Kindergarten is my, like, it's my happy place. Oh my gosh. So how are you doing? What are you enjoying? What do you find challenging, and how do you feel? Where are you in the whole SEL realm and embedding it in curriculum?
Right. So I'm feeling pretty good as a first year teacher. I mean, everything's definitely stressful, and I do have the anxiety of not knowing if I'm doing all the little things correctly, but I have fantastic mentors at school and other friends who are helping me along the way in school. Some things that I find the most challenging is it's an anxiety provoking time for all students. And I really feel very badly when they're feeling anxious or have a lack of confidence. And that's been happening to a couple of my kiddos, is that they just have no confidence in the work that they're doing, and trying to push them into feeling confident and comfortable remote learning is definitely really hard. Are you teaching remotely, or are you in person?
I am. I'm teaching remotely. And so I actually go into the building, into my classroom, which I really kind of like, because the kids get to see their classroom, where you're teaching third grade, I'm teaching kindergarten. So these babies have never been in school before. So I think what helps me, not I think, I know, this is the one thing that I said, and it's been my, like, the steam behind the locomotive that just pushes me. And it always just, ideas just come. I said that I wanted to do everything I possibly can to make this experience be better than the in-person experience. And I also wanted to make, I wanted to create an environment to where if kids had a choice, they would choose this over in-person. And parents, ironically, parents have been sending me emails just saying just that, because we, like, every 9 weeks our kids can switch. And so parents are telling kids, okay, you know, that means you won't get Mrs. Browder. And they're like, well, I don't want to go. And so, yeah, it's just, you know, that it, well, one lady was asking a question on Twitter earlier. Like, she said, how do you, what icebreakers do you use to kind of get kids? Hey, Dennis, how are you?
Hi, Dennis.
Oh, he's connecting. Hey, Dennis. Not yet.
So close.
I'll go ahead, and then when he gets connected,
definitely.
Let me let him know it's saying.
Yeah, I can chat him.
Okay, you got it.
Yes, I can send one over. Oh, he just connected. Never mind. Hey, Dennis, how are you?
Hey, Dennis, can you hear us?
We can hear you.
Can you hear us, Dennis? No.
Okay, I think I finally can hear you.
Can you hear us?
Hi.
Yes, now I can.
Okay, great. Okay,
I was having all types of, like, technical difficulties. Emily, it's good to see you.
Tracy, good to see you too.
It's a pleasure to finally, like, to, like, kind of meet you in person.
I know. So I was like, oh, Dennis, hi.
We've been in, like, plenty of Twitter chats and everything else, and I learned so much from you. So
thank you for being
here with us tonight as well.
Yeah.
And sorry for joining a few minutes late, had some technical difficulties this evening.
That's okay. Tracy was just talking about the environment that she creates for her kindergartners and why they love it so much. And I'm definitely all ears, because I'm all remote right now too.
Me too. Go for it, Tracy.
Well, I'll start by telling, I told her that I said I wanted my kids to, if they had a choice, I teach kindergarten, so of course this is all they know, but if I were teaching first all the way through high school, I would want to create an environment that was so rich and so fun and so passionate that if my kids had a choice to go in person, they wouldn't want to go. And I was just telling her that that's exactly what has been happening, because every 6 to 9 weeks, our kids can choose, well, the families can choose to switch to in-person. And so parents have been explaining to their kids, well, you know, that means you'll have a different teacher. And they email me and say, everything stops right there. But it's, you know, it's the little things, because the lady I was telling you about a minute ago that just sent a message on Twitter saying, you know, what icebreakers do you use to get kids connected? I don't think of it as icebreakers. Like, we're a family, and the parents who are kind of sitting beside them in the screen, you know, so I welcome them in. Like, some parents, I appreciate what they're doing. Like, they're trying to give their kid, their child, the actual classroom environment. Like, if I were in school, I wouldn't be with you. But we have such a unique opportunity to really create community, that community that we've always dreamt of. It's right in front of us. So you know, we do story time and we're weaving in culture, and I look at my screen and it's so diverse. So I'm asking parents to bring pictures, tell us stories, the kids jump in and tell stories. And you know, we have military, we have police, bring your uniforms. Let's talk about it, because in this world full of social injustice, we have an opportunity to hopefully have these kids see that all police officers are not the bad guy. So, you know, that coming on in the morning or that icebreaker, I don't think of it as an icebreaker. It's like I'm at my house and I open my door, and how do I welcome people into my house? You know, so every time, like, I have so many technological problems that I could hear one day when I was having tech problems, a kid said, "Miss Browder's not on yet. I don't hear the music." So those little things that we do, we're creating that routine. Like, I don't know. I just, yeah, it's, they deserve our all, and they deserve our creativity and innovation and just whatever we can do. So I always come on with music, and, but I realized that I needed to give kids more opportunity to talk to each other. So sometimes I don't come on with the music, and I've challenged them. They always say, "Good morning, Mrs. Browder." Like, they're all talking to me. They're not talking to each other. So I started, like, sometimes I don't have the music and I let them talk, and they start learning who plays basketball. I go to dance, I do this. And then the conversation just, and sometimes I don't even get to the lesson. I just let them talk. We have to give them that space.
We're not gonna let your principal know that you don't get to the lesson sometimes. And then they might come like do an observation. just joking. That was the principal with me. I'm sorry. I think you really touched upon something that's really important. Icebreakers are things. And what we need now more than ever is like the human connection piece. And from what I'm gathering, is like you bring the best version of you, even virtually, to your kids. And when you bring the best version of who you are, that's what people connect to. They don't connect to the things or the games that you play. They connect to the point, to the principle of like, you know what? You make me feel welcome. And even when you say like the routines, like I understand routines and like there's a procedure and there's a process, but like routines are really more about how do you fit in your community? Mm-hmm. Where's my place? Where's my purpose? And if you're leading that way, when you welcome kids, and by all means, one of the biggest struggles for me, and I have a great team of kindergarten educators, the question came up is, how do we engage kids that have never been in school before? And I'm like, whoa, like that's a big deal. And I was clueless, but we sat down, we collaborated, and like they're doing phenomenal work. They're dropping things off at home. They're having kids like virtually connect, like give them that talk time like you were just talking about. That's so critical in the educational process. It's not just me talking to you and giving you information. It's making you feel like you belong. And even virtually, you can make people feel like they belong and that they're a part of something special, because that's just the energy we give off. Like, tell me about who you are and why you're here today and what woke you up that got you excited this morning. If I had that type of energy, oh, I want to come back. But if it's turn to page one, this is our agenda, we're going to read a story, answer five questions, who wants to be a part of that? School is supposed to be fun too. And when we talk about that social emotional learning piece, we have to stop disconnecting the part of who we are from it. Like, social, you got to bring the best version of yourself to that classroom every single day, because that's how kids are going to learn how to socialize with one another, no matter what grade level you're in.
Dennis, there was a marked contrast, and it was intentional, in your voice when you were talking about the engagement and how passionate you were. And then you went to that monotone voice. And I'm sitting here thinking like, oh my gosh, if I were a kid and I was listening to that second voice, I'd be checked out in a split second. You know, just how we come, how we present, how we package ourselves makes all the difference in the world. I mean, just wow. So, okay, I got to stop right here because names are so important. So we jumped in and started talking immediately. What did you, not you, Dennis, what did you tell me your name is?
Me?
Yeah.
Emily.
Emily?
Yes, Emily.
Okay, good. I was looking at the chat. I'm like, I don't see her name. I gotta ask. I'm sorry.
Yeah, it's right on my video here.
There it is. I see it now. It wasn't there at first. Yeah, I see it. Okay. Yeah. I just had to ask. I'm sorry, because I have to say name.
No, don't be sorry. Yes. Yeah. Love that.
So, Emily, what do you think about the dialogue we just had? Like, what do you think?
Yeah, it's getting my gears turning. So we do have an adjustment counselor who comes into each of our classes and pulls small groups or does a full group lesson, SEL lessons, which is really nice. So once a week, there's a chunk of time where I'm there too, and we spend time just doing little activities. But I have had like siblings pop into the screen or sometimes parents there, and I've never really thought of doing the home community like you've mentioned. So I'm kind of curious to learn a little bit more about that and how you're mentioning bringing in their jobs and teaching about police officers, if there are any, and like just home and bringing the culture. I'd love to hear how you do that, like appropriately school version because it's home. I think there's a fine line, and that would be awesome.
Well, I wish I, oh my gosh, I can share. Well, I'd love to show you some videos, but so for instance, okay, here's the first thing is not being afraid to make mistakes, mm-hmm. not being afraid to not have all the answers. yeah, I have goosebumps saying that. And like when I'm teaching, it took a while to figure out my space, my virtual instructional delivery space. And so initially, based on logistics, like the wiring, the document camera and things like that, I actually had to sit at my teacher desk, and that was killing me, like sitting and teaching.
I know.
Ugh, I couldn't stand it. So this is what I did. And I just posted this on Twitter to that person I was telling you was asking a question about icebreakers. I actually took my teacher laptop and I went and got a student computer. And so in the middle of the classroom, in front of the screen, the big, you know, Promethean board, mm-hmm. I have my teacher laptop and it faces a student computer. So when I'm teaching, now that I can show you real quick. So this for me was step number one, where I'm not sharing the screen. When you share the screen, you lose them. Like, and I realize that's the setting and the requirement that some people have to have based on their tech setup, but I want the kids to see me all the time. It goes back to that, you know, I want them to have the in-person experience. And the only way they can have that is if, you know, they see me. So I never share my screen. I'm always using all of my videos. Everything I have to deliver is on this screen. So these mm-hmm. are the kids right here. And I'm standing here and I'm pointing to this screen and teaching. And it's like, literally it's this close. So they can see everything. And then I have my easel right here. So I just kind of turn the computer, but they get me 100% of the time. So that's been plus number one. But the other thing is, like with the families, sometimes this is what I do a lot of. Okay. When I'm teaching, I actually talk to the parents too. Like I'm teaching them, you know, parents, when you're teaching the kids at home, go slow when you're blending, and it's okay right now. You know, so when I'm teaching the kids, I pause to teach the parents because they only have us for a little bit of time. They're home with the parents all of the time. So we're not really just teaching kids. We're giving parents tools to facilitate that learning and that instruction. So that step number one is what drew the parents in. So a lot of times when I'm teaching, they're no longer over here. They're like watching, like, what is she doing? What is she doing? So I can do it at home. So that was kind of the draw in, is that I actually talk to the parents. I don't just talk to the kids. Mm-hmm. And so that became, you know, if I'm reading a book, I'm like, what books do you guys have at home like this? So it's not just me delivering the instruction. The other thing I do is, like, I don't teach, even though I'm in my classroom, I don't teach using teacher stuff. I try to, like, that's why you see this. Like, I use paper because I want to show parents how to do this at home.
Paper too, right.
Oh my gosh, they love that. So to me, SEL is more than just an SEL lesson. It's it's literally going to the ends of the earth, trying to connect with these families and showing them that it's not that hard. It's not as hard as we think it is. So yeah, calling and checking on the parents, talking to them, asking them how they're doing. But you ask, here, let me show you real quick. Let me see. I'm trying to find a video real quick to show you.
Take your time.
Learning about the heat energy, warm up your body, get your blood moving. Can you see that?
Send it backwards. Let's go. Good stretch. Good stretch. Oh, yeah. You're going to cross the lounge to move our body. Come on. If you're sitting down, get up out of your seat. Come on, Victor. Come on, Camden. Get moving with us.
So that's my everyday. Like, that's how I teach. And the engagement is amazing. But I want to show you one more thing, if that's okay.
Yeah, of course. Mm-hmm. It's just us.
And you said some really powerful things. So I'm going to piggyback off of something you said when you after you show us the next video.
Okay.
Okay, do you have a big person on a board? What letter is B?
Hang on. So this was after teaching like phonics, and at the end we did something. I'm just going to share it.
Boys. Oh, I'm so proud of you, boys and girls. Look at that.
Can you see?
Jig. Good job. Okay, look at you. Yep, thanks, Grandma. Good job.
See, I brought her in.
Mm-hmm. Okay, now, boys and girls, here's the last one we're going to do right now while we're together. Let's have a little fun. Okay.
Let me fast forward to the... So we were working on jig. I told them to move the j out of the way and find what makes the p sound.
Give me a high five. Super proud of you. Vian, hold on. We don't get upset. You're going to stay with me when we finish this call, okay? And we'll work it out. No need for tears, boys and girls. Sometimes things are hard, but guess what? We can get it done. That's what we do. You know all the problems I have, all the tech problems? Do I cry when things get glitchy? No, I work harder. I work harder and I figure it out. So we're not going to cry. We're going to figure it out. That's what we do in kindergarten.
He started smiling. Girls, listen. He started smiling.
I'll see you back.
I love the energy. That's amazing.
Just take a picture of me.
But I'm really...
Okay. As everybody hangs up the call, Vian, show me your paper, babe. A paper. Show me.
I can't find the best part.
Oh, I see people right.
Let me see if I can find it. Here it is.
Then turn one over on the back. If you don't have another piece of paper, take that J or that B.
Oh, just a little bit. So we can see it a little bit clearer.
Yeah, boys and girls.
Oh, nice hat.
Oh.
I see people writing on their dry erase boards. I see people making pig. Oh, I'm so proud of you. Good job, boys and girls. Sorry.
I can't believe I'm showing y'all this.
Boy, I was proud of you.
But wait a minute.
Move back just a little bit, Tracy, so we can see it. Move back just a little bit, right there.
Hey, can we all celebrate and be little pigs? Are you ready to pig snort with me? Go!
And if you could hear them, they're all snorting. It was... I don't know if you can hear all those little snorts. It was so precious, but just not being afraid to be silly. Mm-hmm. And they'll remember that lesson, you know, and yeah. Oh my goodness. So they look forward to coming to class and they are happy. And that for me is a dream come true in this space that we're in. I mean, in a pandemic, we're locked at home pretty much. And people are not coping, but I have 22 babies who are so full of joy. So we can do it. We can do it. And we can do it.
I just want to say thank you for your passion. Like, I know you just got a little emotional. I want to let you know it, like, touched me too. But you said something, and I think I'm going to, like, tweet this out in a little bit, because I don't want to lose this message. Like, I wrote it down, actually, because I've never heard SEL described this way before. I don't subscribe to the SEL lessons, like, you come in and it's 30 minutes, because when I was in the classroom, we didn't have an SEL time. Like, every moment was a learning opportunity. But you described SEL this way. SEL is more than a lesson. It is going to the ends of the earth to make sure we are all connected. I had chills when you said that. Because when you think about, like, schools, what is the one piece that a lot of people, that a lot of kids disengage in? The connection piece. Because if I don't feel connected with you, how can I feel I can achieve in your classroom? And now let's move that virtually. And let's remember, like, I tip my hat to every educator out here on the virtual platform, but I'm also, like, not going to say we mastered this. This is an adaptive change for many of us. It's going to take some time. When you talk about some being vulnerable, make mistakes, own up to mistakes, like, Emily, I tell people at my job all the time, I make mistakes every single day. And I'm just around a really good team that when I make a mistake, they help pick me up and we keep going. And I try to do the exact same thing for them, because the only thing you can do is make mistakes. We've never done it before, but that is the true essence of learning. Like, you learn more from mistakes than you do from getting it right all the time. And you talk about, like, the sitting versus, like, standing up and teaching. I couldn't stand sitting down and teaching. So I don't know how I would make it right now, because my energy level is, like, too high, and I like to move around and be interactive. And that was under schools of thought when I was in the classroom, you couldn't sit down. Like, you were, that was a red flag if you sat down. And it's so funny that now we're requiring people to sit down to a certain degree to educate kids. Something that, like, we would have never really ever said before, like, that was a good thing. If you were the math teacher sitting at your desk during a lesson and you never got up, you are not deemed an engaging educator.
Absolutely.
But now I need you to sit at your desk.
Oh my goodness.
Really be engaged. So then that challenges some philosophies that we even have about the notion of teaching to begin with in regards to, like, how we're delivering that level of instruction. But then going back to, like, your quote, and I'm going to tweet out a little bit later. So quote, trust me, I'm definitely going to. You talk about the parent perspective. And one thing that we fail to realize is that many of our families that are now adults, they were in school at one point in time. Mm-hmm. Were they engaged? Were they successful in school? So through your interactions that you're creating this environment where connection is big, and not just for the kids, but even for the parents, you're reculturizing them in a sense of what school and community really can be. And that's huge. Like, you didn't forget that just because the camera is on, like, the parents just disappear. Every parent now has live access into who we are as educators, because there's no more closed doors right now.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a great opportunity we can take advantage of. Mm-hmm. And my final thought is, this weekend I experienced a couple of things. And when it comes to SEL, there's one thing that I really, really started, that really hit me hard this weekend, is understanding what we really have control over. And it's not much. We can't control if someone's technology is working. We can't control what someone had for breakfast, what time they woke up to get to class. But you know what you can control? How you come to class, how you come prepared. The energy that you bring when, like you said, I'm gonna turn this music on, I'm gonna give kids the opportunity to talk, I'm gonna make sure that I place myself in every kid's shoes and ask myself, if I was them, would they have enjoyed the experience with me today? And what you're saying holds true to a philosophy that I learned my third year of teaching. I realize now that if my kids have a teacher and they never come home and talk about that teacher, I call the school. Because something's not connected. Like, kids don't talk about school freely as much as they used to. But in your case, you gave the example that when it was time to switch out, they said, oh no, I'm not leaving my teacher.
Mm-hmm.
When kids go home and openly talk to parents a true connection, a true relationship was formed that will set the foundation for not just that moment, but for the rest of their lives. And that's critical, because every year, every kid should have that. Think about how much differently the world would be if that's what we were able to do, every single child, virtually, in person, doesn't matter.
Yep.
And that's when I found out I had a kid once, and I thought that this young lady did not like me. We butted heads. I pushed her really hard on learning in my classroom, and something happened. And one day her mom came up to the school, and I was like, "Hi, I'm Mr. Griffin." And she said, "You're Mr. Griffin." I'm like, "Am I in trouble? You're the person my daughter talks about every night?" I was like, "What do you mean?" Every night my daughter comes home, she talks about how she has to get her work done, how she doesn't want to disappoint you, how you're her favorite teacher. Now, this young lady in person made it seem like she did not like me at all. But if I was to judge my experience based off of how she came off to me, something I had no control over, because I don't know her past experiences. Mm-hmm. But I controlled my expectations. I controlled how I showed up, and I forged a relationship that is still strong even to this day. And she's an adult now. Mm-hmm. Like you said, it's that experience that they never forget, because we feel connected to people.
Yep. Absolutely.
I'm sorry. That quote just really touched me. I'm sorry. That quote, Emily, I apologize.
No, I feel so thankful to have the two of you here tonight. This has been so great. Just listening to everything you have to say, you're so inspirational, and it's really making me excited to go to school tomorrow, even more excited to teach tomorrow.
This space was designed just for you tonight, Emily.
I know, I'm so thankful that the two of you popped on. I thought it was just going to be me. This turned out to be so amazing.
So Emily, I'm glad to be here. Like I said, I'm so glad. I'm happy to be here. I want to share something else. Emily, I'm going to give you something else to think about, really a challenge. Get to know each one of your students intimately. When you're teaching, challenge yourself to call each child by name each day. Don't miss a child. That's always been a personal challenge of mine, because at the end of each day, we want to make sure that each child feels like they were seen. I did that in person too. It's so easy to connect to the kids that always talk. We sometimes miss the kids that don't talk, and they may never talk if we, we'll ask a question from time to time, but if we're not truly bringing them into the fold, we can lose them. So that's just a challenge to keep in mind. But the other thing, when I say intimately get to know each child, I'm looking for an email to show you. There's one particular student in my class. She's not been identified, but I know she's gifted. And I am designing, her mom and I are working together, and we are creating really her own curriculum. She's going to do dioramas. She's going to do a video blog. We're creating this entity, this learning journey, this learning pathway for her. And the mom is beyond overjoyed, because she has an older child. She said nobody has, but whole different story for another time. My son is exceptionally gifted. I mean, really exceptionally gifted. And he's fallen through the cracks, all of that kind of stuff. And so I know what it's like to have a child that's that brilliant, that we tend to focus on the kids who need us, who we have to teach to read, who are struggling. That's who we pour into. We don't necessarily fertilize the kids that are well beyond that. So I want to show you, I created a presentation. Well, it's a work in progress. Mom and I are working together on a Google slide presentation. And that's not what I'm going to show you. I'll read it to you. Mom said, I really love all the ideas for the end projects. This was me talking about dioramas. Does she like video blogs? You know, all of these types of things. She likes to create and also do oral presentations, maybe a combination of the diorama and the vlog. That sounds like something she'd enjoy. She read one of the books you sent on Epic and also a portion of the second already. She's really into it so far. She really likes that access to such variety of books. Thank you for signing her up, blah, blah, blah. And it goes on to say thank you for, you know, all of that great stuff. But that's just meeting each child's needs. So that SEL piece, it's so far beyond just the little activities. It's about giving each child literally the experience of their life. And just, what can you do? Just ask yourself that, what can I do? And don't see limitations, don't see limits, and just go for it. You know, there's no such thing as limitations. And for the kids who, you know, are struggling, make sure you have time with them one-on-one even. Meet with the parents, show them how they can help their kids. So it's about that trust, and it's about wanting the best for every child and giving the best to every child. However you need to do that. But you saw when I was showing you the pig video, how it's woven into my natural delivery of instruction to talk to parents while I'm teaching. And not just teaching them like I showed you, but you heard me say, good job, grandma. Like, I'm air high-fiving parents, and parents are laughing when I do the pig snort. And I'm saying, come on, you got to snort with me, you know, to the parents. And they're embarrassed, but they do it. And so, you know, and it's also about their personal lives. They're at home. So we have an opportunity to know, to learn about their lives. Like when we went to Oklahoma on the weekend, I took pictures. The trees were so beautiful. I just took video and I showed it to them. So they're sharing with me, like, that's, if you want to say icebreaker, that's some of the stuff we do when we come on. Like if they saw family over the weekend, which is so precious and so few for and in between, they're sharing that. One of them showed picking peppers out of their grandfather's garden because we were talking about plants. So when they show me this stuff, like, we stop and talk about it, or we're having conversations on the side and I ask them to send me the pictures, and then I create a Google slide. So I'm showing it on that second computer, but the parent and the child are actually talking to the class about the experience. So we get the lesson, we get the work done. My kids are reading in kindergarten. They are reading, they are writing 2 and 3 pages full. I mean, wow. The teaching is rock solid. But the passion supersedes the learning. And I think because of the passion, the learning is really, really easy, really easy.
Well, I love that. And I know I accept the challenge welcomely. That's been one of my biggest problems recently, especially as a first year teacher. I'm having a hard time like divvying up my time, and I'm finding myself spending most of my time with my lower students because they need so much one-on-one help. And those who are on track or finishing things quickly and perfectly, I feel like I'm kind of just pushing off to the side sometimes. And I don't want to feel like that. And that's definitely been one of my biggest challenges. So working with the parents is a great idea to give some challenging work, extra projects. That would be a good suggestion.
And I know even when you're talking about like, go ahead.
No, go ahead, Dennis.
I remember. Go ahead.
All I was going to say, it'll be quick, Emily, is when you're delivering that whole group instruction and like the kids who are further ahead or things come easy to them, they're finishing quicker. Like for me, when we're writing sentences, like I said, I have some kids who can write 2 and 3 pages. But a lot of the kids are working on developing one sentence. So,
right.
In class, I have soft music playing. I'm helping kids sound out their words, but the other kids who can go ahead and write, like sometimes it started out where they just be sitting there. I'm like, let me see your sentence. I like to go to the park. Now tell me what you like to do at the park. If you could go to the park with friends, who would you go with? And so they're like, oh, okay. And so if you look at my class on a screen, it looks like it does in person, because you see the kids that I'm helping almost in a small group sense, like 3 and 4 kids at a time, I'm helping sound out their words. Now I'm not that good, so I have to write down what their sentence is so I can refer back to it and know you know, whose word I'm helping who on, if that makes sense. But then other kids who are finishing like 3 and 4 sentences or a page, they're showing me and I'm reading, or I'm, no, you read to me, read me. My gosh. And I'm asking them questions. So, you know, we can do all of that simultaneously. Does that make sense? Does that help?
Yeah, it does. It does.
I'm going to jump in very quickly on this. One of the things that you were talking about making sure that you reach all kids, even when you think about like the PLC process, and this is something that even virtually we're going to continue to work on at our school, is that fourth question is, what do you do for kids that already learned it, that already know it? And that tends to be a question that we tend not to get to as much. So right. You're talking about like really enhancing SEL and making sure that all kids are getting what they need. We have to make sure that we're paying attention to that question, because we spend a lot of time into what do we do for our kids that don't know it. Well, there's another arena of kids too. And Tracy, you said something else. I might have to tweet this out and quote you for this one too. You said the teaching is solid. That's huge, because that speaks to a high level of confidence. And in this virtual platform, something that has happened, people's confidence sometimes is shaken, because they're on display in front of so many others that they start to alter what they would have traditionally done. No, you can still be the same educator. The platform just changed. But the knowledge and the skill set that you have has remained the same. The pedagogy is still the same. The collaboration is still the same. The engagement, the interaction, it's still the same. Like, we could sit here, going back to that monotone conversation, we could just sit here and say, yes, SEL is this, this is the definition, but we wouldn't get anything out of that. Emily, you already said, like, you're excited about going to work tomorrow.
Like, you're inspiring me.
Like, that type of energy, if you don't have people like that in your circle, I would advise you to reach out and get some people like that in your circle. Now, Tracy, I don't want to snort, but I just want to come in your classroom. But I don't want to snort, though. Like, I don't want to snort, but I just want to, like, come in. But then I feel, because, see, learning is a non-negotiable for you. The engagement is a non-negotiable for you. And sometimes people feel like kids have a choice in being engaged or not. No, when you know that the teaching is solid, but you supersede that with your passion, oh, I want to be a part of that. Everybody wants to be a part of something great, something bigger than themselves, a part of a community. But nobody wants to be a part of anything that lacks passion. Because if you lack passion, you lack purpose, you lack vision. So, like, I know coming to your room, I'm like, oh, there's purpose in that room because there's passion there. That means there's a vision of high levels of student learning. And even if I was a student that wasn't achieving at the moment, guess what? I know I'm going to get there, because you're going to give me what I need. You're going to support me. But I do have a question for you, because you do a lot. How do you, and Emily, I'm going to have to ask you this question too.
Okay.
How do you both make time for the SEL for yourself? Like, I know we're talking about the kids, and like, yes, I can tell both of you invest a lot into the kids. And there's something that I'm really trying to take heed to this year, is that you can't pour from an empty cup. And I used to be that one. I was pouring from an empty cup sometimes. Like, I was like scraping the final drips in my vase to like give to someone else, and my pitcher to give to someone else. In the midst of all of this, how are you developing a high level of SEL for yourself?
Emily, you want to go first?
Well, I mean, that's definitely difficult to accomplish nowadays, but two things that I'm thinking of. One is there's not many hours in the day, and I feel as though sometimes you come home and I'm still doing work and then I'm tired and we do it all over again. But so during school, I've tried incorporating things that I enjoy too. Like, I'm in a band and I really love singing. And so I've tried to incorporate music and talking about that in my class, because it's fun for me to talk about that. And then they're interested and we can have conversation. So I'm not just listening to things that they like to talk about. I'm also talking about myself. And I think that bringing in things that I like into class is enjoyable for me. It makes it fun. And then even in quarantine, like I'm living with my friend Molly, who's not here tonight, but she usually is a panelist too. And sometimes I was teaching remotely and I was just home all by myself and there was nobody around. And I really feed off of conversations and socializing. And I felt sad that I was just gonna have lunch break for an hour with nobody around me, like lunch and recess. So I invited the kids for lunch bunch and I had them talk to me. And I think just so socialization and talking really kind of like feeds me. And so any time that I can just spend with kids just talking outside of curriculum is really nice. And then bringing things that I love into class too, that makes me want to be in class even more and have them learn about me, has been two things that has been helpful. How about you, Tracy?
I would say for me, no, I am so proud of something that I'm doing this year that I have wanted to do for so many years. And I attribute this to my husband. I am walking to school. We ride our bikes together. Like he'll actually ride his bike with me and then he'll continue his bike ride. Then I take a walk at my lunch break and then I ride my bike home. So the plus in that is I've lost so much weight. It is insane. And it just keeps falling off. And now it's like, I watch what I put in my mouth because I can see the change in my body, you know, and just that health piece is huge. So in the pandemic, I am praying for our world, but I am so happy. I think the key is finding your joy, no matter the obstacles. And I am so committed to continually finding my joy in the midst of a storm.
That's really powerful. Yeah. Thank you both for those answers. Like that, well, you guys are giving me chills today.
Well, Dennis, I'm turning it on you because you carry the weight of a school. And you're in the middle because you have your school looking up to you and your district and all the pressure that comes with that in a global pandemic. So what are you doing for self-care?
I'm learning how to like try to cut it off. Like for the staff, I really try to make it a point that they stop everything at a certain hour. That I don't want you working past this hour, because when the pandemic first happened and we had to go virtual, one thing that I noticed is that our home lives were bleeding into our school lives and you couldn't separate the two. Mm. Like I had teachers that were in like just trying to be responsive to parents, answering emails, talking to parents, working with them 8-9 o'clock at night. Well, then how do you have time for yourself to be energized for the next day? Mm. A lot of the satisfaction that I received, to be quite honest with you, is seeing the growth of people around me and seeing them step up saying like, Dennis, I'll take this off your plate so you can go focus on this. Because it is always a lot. There's always something. But to know that I can, like the real test for me for like leadership is like being able to grow other leaders. And if I'm around people and I can't determine if they're growing or not, that means there's something that I'm doing wrong. And I don't go to work and say I'm the principal or I'm the leader or I'm this and I'm that. We're just an effective team. And what do we need to be that effective team? I'm more intentional about trying to spend time with my family. My daughter is a senior in high school and she's getting ready to go to college next year. I wish that she wasn't having to experience this during a pandemic. Emily, I wish this wasn't your first year of teaching in the middle of a pandemic. I'm just going to be honest with you.
Yep.
But at the same time, there's so much that we can learn from it if we just sit back and truly embrace the dissonance that's there. Mm-hmm. And that's been a challenge for me because we're all striving to be perfect. And Tracy, you brought up a really great point. You do have like, it's actually like three entities actually, because you also have to add the parent factor. And it's how do you meet the needs of so many and you can't even be by them? And for me, my interaction style is more in person. I like to actually engage with people in person and talk to them in person and listen to them in person. So it's been a real challenge for me. More than half of my students are virtual. So myself and certain administrators, we tried to go into classrooms and like, hi, how are you doing? And talk virtually. Jason Love, who's another panelist on here, we have these morning announcements that we do every morning, and he's taking them to another level where we record them and get them out there to people. But it's really, I pray a lot more. I read a lot more. I try to take time for like what's the most important piece, knowing that you're never going to get everything done and you have to become okay with that. But just know that you're making strides to continue to advocate and create change in our world. Because talking with members of my district office, one thing that we've said was we have to be honest. There was a pandemic before this pandemic. We did have a significant number of students that weren't learning at a high level. And if you don't have access to a high quality education, what are the possible outcomes that you have moving forward? And Emily and Tracy, like, I'll be honest with you, thinking about that all the time, it is hard to make time for myself to recharge because I'm always thinking, what do teachers need that can deliver high levels of instruction so that even in the middle of a pandemic, we can say our kids are still learning and growing at really high levels. So I haven't mastered it. I'm probably the worst person to ask that question to. I probably didn't even answer the question, to be quite honest with you, because I'm just not really good at it yet. I eat lunch every day now. Like that I do. Like before, that's I didn't eat huge. Lunch. So, and I gained like over 20 pounds in this pandemic, and I'm happy about that. So I know I'm not supposed to say that, and people that, anyone that listens to this, I'm so sorry for saying that, but you understand, for a long time I couldn't gain weight, and now I'm actually gaining weight, and I exercise a little bit more. So like, Tracy, it's the opposite effect for me, but like, I'm loving it. Yeah. I do have a cap, like I'm not trying to exceed a cap, but I don't want to tell anybody how much I weigh though, at the same time.
Well, Dennis, you said, you know, you felt like you might not be answering, but in fact, you did, and you did wonderfully. You know, you say you would love to come in my classroom. I would love to watch you lead, because to me, you sound like you lead with a servant heart. And just like I know I get passionate when I talk about teaching, you get passionate when you talk about leading, but it's by serving others. You know, those teachers, those parents, the district, the desire to be face-to-face, but you're not. So you're hopping into those classrooms. You know, the other person you talked about doing the announcements and just figuring out other ways to connect. It's important that kids see more than just their teacher face, because if they were at school, they would see people in the cafeteria, they'd see the counselor, they'd see you. And so we can still give them that experience, and you're doing that.
And one of the mantras that we are really championing at our school this year, everyone oftentimes says like at school, every kid should have at least one trusted adult in the building. I challenge that notion every single time. Shouldn't every kid know that every adult in the building is a trusted adult for them in the building? Mm-hmm. I mean, just think about that concept. Like there are kids and our parents can attest to it. And if we're really honest, we can even attest to it, that we had teachers that we feel we weren't really connected to. Mm-hmm. Because I always tell people, like, when you graduate from high school, there's this moment where you think about every single teacher you had and you start to rank them like, these were my best, and these are the ones, I don't know. And like now I thank all teachers because they gave me something, even if I didn't realize it at that moment. Mm-hmm. But I told all of my kids when I taught them, like, listen, and at the end of the day, I will be in your top three. I will be either number two or number three, because honestly, I can't be number one. I could never compete with a kindergarten teacher. I mean, there are just so many different variables that you had at your disposal that I couldn't have. Like, I just couldn't.
See, you start, you will.
But they wouldn't let me. But I just knew I couldn't qualify for that number one spot because, like there's some teachers that are kindergarten teachers that are close to my heart. But I said, I will be two or three when it's all said and done. And but that goes back to that confidence level. It wasn't really necessarily that I had all the content pieces mastered. I was just confident, because I knew every single day when you walked into my room, I was going to give you something to talk about. Mm-hmm. Hopefully it was good, though. That was the only thing. Hopefully it was a good thing.
And I know it was.
Well, I feel so thankful that the two of you were here tonight, and we have gone 10 minutes over because you have so many wonderful things to say. And I'm lucky to hear all of them. I'm so happy tonight. Thank you so much.
Emily, we learned a lot from you too now, okay? Thank you for your passion. We thank you for being vulnerable enough to even talk about like how it is as a first year educator engaging in SEL virtually in the middle of a pandemic. Like, that's not easy. Like, I really wish people truly understood the challenges that are in front of us. Mm-hmm. But the fact that you're not trying to avoid the challenges, that you're engaging, that you're reaching out and learning from others, I know your kids are, every kid in your classroom is in good hands. Tracy, it was just a pleasure meeting you finally face to face. I can't wait to do it in person one day, though.
I know, one day. Hey, Emily, my email address is... What'd you say?
Yes, I was going to ask you for your Twitter as well.
Oh, yeah, it's Tracy.
I was going to ask you for your Twitter as well.
Tracy.
I'll go ahead and stop recording first.